Greetings everyone. Welcoming you all for the presentation titled Demystifying PCI Performance and Tuning Parameters. This is Pratham Naman, working as System Structure Design Engineer in Foundry Design Services team of Samsung Semiconductors. My colleagues and co-authors, Mr. Pankaj and Mr. Dahatya, I'll be presenting for the day, and myself along with the co-authors will address all your queries at the end of the presentation. Let's go to the next slide. In the next slide, we have the agenda detailing the upcoming contents. The presentation starts with an introduction which specifies the need or motivation of this analysis, which showcases how PCIe has a much wider bandwidth when compared to the other stated protocols and why PCIe bandwidth needs to be utilized to the maximum extent possible. Following the motivation slide is the factors or parameters which affects the performance of the PCIe based systems, where each factor has been identified and segregated based on its tuning flexibility. The next topic will be the in-depth analysis of some of the important factors which shows a significant impact when tuning, such as PCIe link speed, link width, the maximum payload size, the maximum read request size, the overheads due to ECRC and encoding schemes, the latencies due to ASPM intra-exit, and some link level mechanisms such as scale flow control, maximum outbound non-posted requests are also considered here. Finally, this presentation concludes how these factors help improve the performance of the PCIe incorporated system and how the analysis can be extended. Let's dive into the contents. As many of you are aware here, PCIe is a high-speed interconnect being favored by most SoC designers for high-speed data transfers between the subsystems. The PCIe protocol, which was first introduced as a local bus standard, has become a standard bus specification which improved the performance of high-performance computing and automotive applications. PCIe is not now restricted only to the computing applications, but also to many applications which is used for non-computing purposes also. The PCIe SiC devises the protocol to support future enhancements by making the IP convenient for speed upgrades and better encoding techniques. Though the PCIe speeds are tremendous when we consider standalone, things become different when they are incorporated into an SoC. Many factors, including link width, payload size, data path latency, PXRX buffer size, plays a crucial role in determining the performance of the PCIe incorporated system. These factors need to be considered when designing a PCIe based system, which focuses on either having a high performance or high power saving use cases. Some of the tuning factors are flexible in such a way that it can be tuned even during system's runtime, which can be improved in such a way that if there is a user space application or a software which is running on top of the system, the software can tweak it during the runtime operation, thereby it can switch to a low power mode or a high performance mode. This enhances the system's flexibility, where it can switch between power and performance on need basis. Therefore, the SoC designer has to understand the trade-off between the cost and the performance of the system, which can be tweaked to align with the use case of the system. The designer has to consider the accessibility of tuning these factors and provide hardware registers or software loops so that the user space applications or the end users can switch the system to enter into the performance or power saving mode. This presentation explores the tuning factors available in a PCIe incorporated system. The presentation utilizes the SoC, which has a Synopsys designed by PCIe controller. We can have a look into the tuning factors in the upcoming slides. Let's move on to the next slide. This slide shows the list of factors which are segregated based on their affinity to the PCIe IP present in the system. So we have segregated it based on the protocol level, the OS level, and the IP configuration. On the protocol level, we have ASPM latencies, which considers how entering and exiting the ASPM state during heavy workload affects the performance. Then followed by the ECRC and encoding scheme, which details the overhead of CRC and encoding techniques on the data which being transmitted on particular PCIe generation bus. On the operating system level, we have the operating frequency of the SoC. This operating frequency can cause propagation delay from the application to the PCIe buffers, thereby reducing or impacting the performance of the PCIe-based system. The other factor is the ability of the processor for multi-threading, where different processors can access the PCIe port in parallel. Improving the multi-threading concept also improves the PCIe performance of a particular system. Next, moving to the PCIe IP configuration level, we have the maximum payload size and the maximum read request size, highlighting the relationship between the PCIe buffer size and performance. The link speed and the link width is also considered, which shows the correlation between the number of links and the transmission speed on each link. And finally, the scale flow control and the maximum outbound non-posted request is also considered. In the upcoming slides, we will be discussing about some of the parameters and its usability, whether they can be configured during design time or in runtime, or whether it gives a significant boost to the performance or power saving features of the system. Let's move to the next slide. This slide gives a glimpse of the test bench which we have used to capture the throughput by tuning the hardware registers. So our test bench consists of a host processor which has PCIe dual role controller, but for this specific purpose which has been configured in a root complex mode. On the other side, we have an ARM64 based SoC which has a PCIe dual role controller configured in endpoint mode. Both the endpoint and the root complex are Gen 4 capable and can link up with a maximum link width of 4. The test bench also utilizes almost all the links which is available and then performs the test accordingly. We have used a custom tweaked Linux driver, commonly available user space and bare metal software to access the tunable registers to capture the throughput. The software test bench plays a major role in capturing the time taken for the transferring data between the controllers. The test bench utilizes the embedded PCIe DMA controller to transfer the data. The time interval between the software ringing the doorbell of DMA and the done notification from the DMA is captured and the transfer rate is calculated. Since the transfer rate is being calculated, this is calculated based on the size of data being transmitted. This experiment is repeated for different data sizes ranging from 1 byte until 2 megabytes. We brought out all the data from the test bench and a graph has been plotted based on the captured data with multiple tuning parameters being tuned at the different test levels, which we'll be looking in the upcoming slides. The first factor which we are about to look into is the encoding overhead. In order to maintain the TC balance on the transmission lines, the PCIe uses encoding schemes. This encoding scheme varies across the generations. Let's take an example here. For PCIe Gen 1 and Gen 2, the protocol follows 8/10 bit encoding schemes. This proves the fact that an additional 2 bits are being overhead to the 3 PCIe throughput here, which is roughly 20% here. Ideally, if we calculate the bandwidth for Gen 1 based systems, the actual bandwidth only corresponds to 80% of the protocol specified transfer rate, which roughly translates to 250 megabytes per second on a single link. This is a similar case for Gen 2 also, which is 500 megabytes per second. However, this overhead gets minimized in Gen 3 and Gen 4 based systems where 128/130 bit encoding is being followed. This reduces the throughput overhead from 20% to mere 1.5%, thereby doubling the practical bandwidth from Gen 2 to Gen 3. Unlike other factors, encoding overhead is a protocol specified and must be followed for proper working of PCIe. It cannot be tuned for better performance. However, the user can still decide on proceeding with the gym based on the use case and size of the router. Let's say if the use case is based on using the PCIe lanes for any graphical applications, the graphical application can effectively use most of the PCIe bandwidth, should opt for higher PCIe speeds, thereby transferring more data on a single transfer. Any other application which involves only few or lesser number of transfers can go to a lower generation speeds also. Let's go to the next slide. The next factor which we are about to look into is the link speed and the width. Usually, PCIe width is specified as the number of lanes onto which the PCIe root complex and the endpoint can successfully link up and perform data transfer in parallel on the successfully linked up lanes. The PCIe speed is the actual rate in which the data is being transmitted. As per the protocol, the link speed determines the number of PCIe transactions possible and it is measured in giga transfers per second. Theoretically, if we calculate the PCIe bandwidth for the single lane and in the single direction, it will be as similar to that of what it is specified in the table here. So for the Gen 1, in giga transfers per second, it is 2.5 and in megabytes per second, it is 250, followed by the Gen 2, which is 5 GT per second and 500 megabytes per second. For Gen 3, it is 8 GT per second and 1 gigabytes per second. And in Gen 4, it is 16 giga transfers per second and 2 gigabytes per second here. The maximum which is achieved in our thresh bench is Gen 4 speeds, which is 2 gigabytes per second. Though we have PCIe Gen 5 and Gen 6, which is double and 4 times of Gen speed. However, in order to calculate the actual bandwidth, the designer has to consider the efficiency of the data being transferred, the number of lanes, and the encoding overhead also. So, the actual bandwidth will be the number of lanes multiplied by the data rate on each lane, multiplied by the encoding overhead, and the efficiency. So, we were able to capture the performance impact due to link speed and link width change in our test bench. So, we captured the performance data from speeds ranging from Gen 1 to Gen 4, where all the data ranges which has been transferred has been captured, the bandwidth has been captured for all the data ranges, and it is plotted. So in all the test bench cases, the MPS and the MRRS, which is the max payload size and the max rate required size, has been kept to the maximum value possible, which is 512 bytes in MPS case in our test bench and 4096 bytes for MRRS in our test bench. To perform the data transfer between the link partners, we have used other PCIe's internal DME so that it performs block transfer. And it also provides an efficient way to capture the read and the write rates here. The effective bandwidth has been captured based on the data size ranging from 1 byte to 2 megabytes, which is transferred on the PCIe bus for all the 4 speeds and multiple link widths, let's say between X2 or X4 link width. And that plot has been done based on the data which we have captured. These plots will be analyzed in the upcoming slides. Before getting into the plots, let's look into the prototype code for where we were able to dynamically switch between the link speeds and the link width without performing a hard reset or a soft reset here. The controller which we have used provide features such as speed up configuration, directed link speed and link width change, which is available in the form of hardware registers. And we have used a custom tweaked bare metal code to configure these values through software. The reference code will be helpful where for the application designers to switch between the performance and the power saving features based on their need. It also allows the user to configure the link speed and the link width dynamically so that any configuration related changes or any broken links can also be fixed in this method. Let's go to the next slide. Based on the dynamic link speed and width change, we were able to capture the performance data for all capable speech in the test bench, ranging from Gen 1 to Gen 4. The MPS and MRR is kept to the maximum value possible, which is 5,496, and we have used DMA to capture the read and the write rates. On the left side, you could see the graph which actually plotted based on the read transfers, and on the right side, we have all the data which has been captured based on the write transfer. The effective bandwidth is being captured based on the transferring of data of size ranging from 1 byte to 2 megabytes for all 4 speeds, and it has been plotted here. From the read and write plot, we could understand that from sizes ranging from 1 byte until 1 kilobyte, whatever may be the generations, the performance is almost similar. So the user or the developer has to understand the fact that even though we are trying to send PCIe data on the PCIe bus, we could still see similar performance on all the generations here. So which shows the fact that the user can switch to a lower generation, or he can switch off for a dynamic link downgrade whenever the user is trying to transmit the data which is less than 1 KB. And for sizes ranging from 1 KB to 1 megabyte here, the speed, dynamic speed kicks in, where the performance gets improved based on the protocol specified transfer rate. And for each speed ranging from Gen 1, Gen 2, Gen 3, Gen 4, the performance is directly proportional to the data rate in which it is getting transmitted, which is also seen on the graphs for the read as well as in the write case. For sizes greater than 2 MB, the performance gets saturated since the PCIe maximum bandwidth is being occupied by the large data sizes, and it aligns to the maximum possible data rate for the each generation. So the developer or the designer has to understand these facts and design their application based on the use case, whether they can switch to low power mode by switching to lower generation speeds, or have a high performance applications running with highest possible speed in this case here. Let's move to the next slide. Similar to the previous experiment we have done for the link speed, we have also captured data for the link width here, where the link width has been kept to x2 and x4, and the link speed has been kept to the maximum value possible, which is Gen 4 here. Similar to the link speed performance, we could understand the similar fact here, where from data size ranging from 1 byte until 1 kilobyte, the performance doesn't deviate to the maximum extent possible. It is as similar to that of what it is in case of X2 as well as in X4 links. The performance gets improved as the size increases from 1 kilobytes to 1 megabyte, and similarly saturates for sizes greater than 2 megabytes. This is due to the fact that the PCIe maximum bandwidth is being used or utilized by the data which is getting transmitted, and it is actually proportional to the corresponding data rate of the particular generation. So if the transfer size is less than 1 KB, the user can switch to a smaller link width in order to save the power. This will be very useful for the low power saving applications here. Let's go to the next slide. So the next slide talks about the max payload size and the max read request size. The maximum payload space specifies the largest payload size the device can support for a single transfer. This usually depends on the least value supported by all the link partners in the PCIe 3, which is the weakest link in the PCIe 3. The MRRS defines the maximum size which the link partner can request for a read transfer. Based on the MRRS size, the link partner requesting for a read will prepare buffers for the incoming response. The lesser the MPS and the MRRS, the more time it takes to write the data into the link partners. And specifically, the lesser the MRRS is, the more pending read request will happen on the RC side when we are transferring data sizes greater than the PCIe maximum transmissible unit. And this is not specific on the RC side, it is actually based on the link partner who transmits the data, which we can investigate in the next upcoming slides here. So similar to the dynamic link speed and link width application, we have used a similar test bench here where we capture the performance data for different MPS and MRRS values. So in order to achieve this, we are not performing any soft reset or any hard reset. Instead, we use a user space application which is based on Linux environment where the user space application namespace PCL changes the MPS and the MRRS values of the link partners on either side and triggers the link retraining. So after the link retraining, the MPS and the MRRS values gets changed to the corresponding value which we are trying to program in our test bench. So this script will be helpful where the users can understand how switching between the lowest MPS and or the highest MPS is possible without doing a soft reset or a hard reset here. The user can also switch between the MPS and the MRRS based on the link to which they are trying to communicate here. If that is the case, the MPS and MRRS concept will not depend on the weakest link in the tree, but then it will be dynamically changing for all the links which has a maximum capability here. The script reference which has been provided in the upcoming slide will show how the device control capability field is modified to change the MPS and the MRRS values here. And finally, the performance data has been captured by transmitting different data sizes for different MPS and MRRS. And the speed has been kept to Gen 4 and the width has been kept to Gen X4 in the test bench to perform this operation. We can look into the analysis in the upcoming slides. So similar to the dynamic link speed and link width modification based on the bare metal custom tweaked firmware, we were able to use a commonly available user space application based on Linux called shapePCL, which will dynamically change the MPS and the MRRS for the link partners and trigger the link retraining here. So if you could see the reference purpose code which we have provided here, the script actually uses a shapePCL to change the device control capability field and it changes the MPS and the MRRS value for the root complex as well as the endpoint device on the same script here. So the script will change the root complex device capability field, and then from the root complex, it configures the endpoint device capability field also. And it changes the MPS and the MRRS values, which is desired based on the test bench we are running. Since we are changing the MPS and the MRRS dynamically, this script will be running for all the cases, let's say like for the ranges of MPS from 128 until 512, and for ranges of MRRS from 128 until 4096. So after configuring the device control capability field, this script actually triggers the link retraining so that the entire PCIe state machine gets configured based on the MPS and MRRS value, which has been configured newly here. If you see in the script which has been provided here, the device control capabilities field has been specified as offset 78 here, which is corresponding to our test bench and the controller which we have used in our test bench. This offset will be varying for other systems and the other PCIe controller which is used in their systems. So based on this, the user can identify the device control capability field and use a similar script to make changes accordingly. We can see how this is impacting the PCIe performance in the upcoming slides. So we were able to capture the performance data for different values of MPS and MRRS on Gen 4 speed and X4 width test bench. So for the initial experiment, we kept the MRRS to be the maximum value possible, which is 4096 bytes in our test bench. For the read as well as in the write case, we did vary the MPS size from 128 until 512 for the transfers via PCIe internal DMA. In both read as well as in the write case, the plot shows similar performance for data sizes until 16 kilobytes, which roughly proves the fact that for sizes from 1 byte until 16 kilobytes, whatever the data being transmitted, the performance is one and the same on both all the MTS values here. After 16 kilobytes, that is for the sizes greater than 16 kilobytes, the performance improves for the highest maximum payload size, which is the MPS here. And the highest the maximum payload size, the better the performance, which is evident from all the graphs which we have plotted. So the performance gets improved for the maximum payload size of 512 bytes, and it saturates to the maximum protocol specified bandwidth here. So if the user wants to occupy the complete bandwidth and use the complete PCIe bus for the data transfer throughout the process, we can switch to a maximum payload size of the maximum value for the corresponding leaf and perform the read or the write transfers accordingly. Therefore, it is recommended to switch to the maximum possible value for better performance here. A similar experiment is done here, keeping the MPS to the maximum possible value, which is 512 bytes. The MRRS is now switched from 128 bytes until 4096 bytes, and the plot has been captured based on the different data size transmitted on a Gen 4 X4 link. So if we can see on the DMA read side, the performance gets improved when the MRRS size is increased from 128 to 512, which is evident from the graph that after 1 kilobytes of data, the performance gets improved based on the MRRS values. The higher the MRRS value, the better the performance. However, we could see from the graph that after the 512 byte mark of the MRRS, the performance remains one and the same. This is due to the fact that the maximum payload size is still 512 bytes, which results in bandwidth capped to the maximum after 512 bytes. However, on the DMA write side, changing the MPS value, keeping the MPS value to the fixed value and changing the MRRS value to the maximum possible does not give any performance improvements here. This proves the fact that the maximum read request size concept comes only in the read picture and not in the write picture, which is evident from the experiment which we have done in our test batch. Let's move to the next slide. So the next factor which we are about to look into is the end-to-end CRC overhead here. This is an optional feature being provided in the PCIe specification, which improves the AER feature of the PCIe. ECRC makes the whole transaction reliable up till transaction layer, as the LCRC is being recalculated for the packet at every egress port of the routing element. Every TLP has an ECRC packet appended at the end, which is of 4 bytes here. This adds an additional overhead to the performance of the PCIe. Therefore, if the designer is aware and conscious of the environment in which the PCIe work is stable, they can skip enabling of ECRC here. Considering the use of ECRC is debatable, as solutions like network interface card, which utilizes PCIe interface, occupies larger PCIe bandwidth for longer durations, and this might lead to performance problem. But the user should also consider using the DMA in the case of having end to CRC enabled, where there could be significant improvement when DMA is enabled here and ECRC is enabled, because the DMA is trying to perform a block data transfer and the ECRC, which is of 4 bytes, get uploaded for each block in this case. We can analyze our test bench which has the DMA enabled case, and we can see how ECRC enabling or disabling is impacting the performance or not. Let's move to the next slide. So in order to identify whether the ECRC overhead is affecting the performance in our test bench where the DMA is enabled, we have captured the time taken to transfer the data size ranging from 1 byte up till 2 megabytes at Gen 4 X4 speeds. So, in similar to the previous test cases, we have kept the maximum payload size to the maximum value, which is 512, The maximum read request size here is kept to the maximum value, which is 4096, and the DMA has been used to perform read transfer as well as the write transfer here. So from the read as well as in the write graphs, we could see that the ECRC enablement or disablement shows no significant difference in both cases, as we have used the DMA based transfer for read as well as in the write case, and the ECRC is being calculated for the entire block. So this ECRC is appended at the end of the each block, where the block size is larger, which is actually equal to that of the maximum payload size which is getting transmitted here. For the 512 bytes, the 4 bytes is a mere small overhead which does not provide maximum performance improvements when disabled here, and that is evident from the graphs which we could see. The ECRC overhead will be significantly observed in the CPU based transfers, as the burst size of CPU will be lesser when compared to that of the DMA. For instance, if the burst size of CPU will be 4 bytes, the appending of ECRC, which is additional 4 bytes, occupies 50% of the data which bandwidth which we are trying to utilize here. So the user can switch to the DMA based transfers if he wants to enable ECRC, considering the fact that the channel, the PCIe channel in which the data is getting transmitted, is not secure enough. This will definitely improve the performance on the reliability of the system, where ECRC enabling is proven to provide CRC support until the transaction layer. So the next factor which we have in our list is the ASPM exit latencies here. ASPM, which is being part of the PCIe protocol, has specification which allows PCIe controller to enter into low power state such as L0S, L1 and L2. These L0S, L1 and L2 provide its own power saving mechanisms, where the clock, the particular file domains, everything has been disabled in a stepwise manner for different levels, which is L0S, L1 and L2. Though this feature offers more power saving features, it also impacts the PCIe bandwidth, as there are latencies when exiting the ASPM state. In order to perform the data transfer on the bus, the ASPM exit should happen, and only then the ASPM will be disabled and the data transfer will go on the bus successfully. The previous use case of network interface card, which always keeps the PCIe bus busy, the performance will decrease due to L1 exit latencies when ASPM is enabled for the network interface card case. Usually, for the controllers, the default exit latency and the entry latency values will be made hardware configurable. And in our test bench, we could see that it is configured to the value of 64 microseconds by default. In our test bench, this is a hardware configuration which can be modified only during the IP design and not in runtime via software. Based on the analysis which we are about to do in the upcoming slide, the user can decide on whether to keep this parameter as a hardware configurable parameter, or they can switch to the software based configurable parameter, where the software can control this entry or exit latencies and then design the system accordingly, so that in case the system definitely requires an ASPM, they can switch to the lesser value, which is less than 64 microseconds here. We can see how ASPM is impacting the performance of PCIe in the upcoming slides. So in the test bench, we have kept the maximum payload size to be 512 bytes and the maximum read request size to be the 4096 bytes. The Gen 4 X4 link has been used for reference here, where we were able to transmit data of size ranges from 1 byte until 2 megabytes for all the transfers. The data, the bandwidth has been captured and it has been plotted here. We could see that the performance improves for the considerable margin between ASPM enabled un-HPM disabled case for data sizes ranging from 1 KB up till 1 MB. From the graph, it is significant that the performance improvement is in the order of even ranging from 100 megabytes until 1 gigabyte also, and shows similar performance after 2 megabytes, which proves the fact that once the 2 megabyte size is hit, when the ASPM is enabled or not, it doesn't matter. The bandwidth gets saturated. So if the user is trying to perform a data transfer of sizes greater than 2 MB on the PCI bus continuously, enabling or disabling the ASPM case will have no impact here. If the data size which is getting transmitted is less, then the user can decide on whether to have the ASPM enabled in the user space application, or it can be disabled based on the requirements. So we have getting to the last slide here. The last parameter which we are about to look into is the scale flow control and the maximum outbound non-posted request. The scale flow control and the maximum outbound non-posted request comes into picture only for PCI Gen 4 speeds and above, and it is not considered for the speeds below, which is Gen 1, Gen 2 and Gen 3. As we have a limitation of 127 header credits and 2047 data credits on the previous generation, the PCI link performance gets affected due to insufficient credits to account for the route trip time. To address this, the scale flow control mechanism has been introduced in Gen 4, which scales the maximum outstanding header and data credits by a factor of either 1 or 4 or 16. The design layer controller, which we have used, provides a hardware configuration to enable this feature in the data link feature register. The user who is about to consider this feature to be enabled or disabled can decide on whether this value can be hardware configurable or a software configurable value. Our test bench had this register value configured to the enabled state during the hardware configuration state itself. So whatever experiment which has been done until now has the max scale flow control enabled here. The next factor, which is the maximum outbound non-posted request, specifies the minimum number of simultaneous outbound PCI non-posted requests in total for all functions. Based on the non-posted request, the SOC incorporating the PCI can size the completion lookup table to identify the completion timeout. It also helps in configuring the completion header queue RAM when you configure completions in store and forward or cut to modes. Similar to the scale flow control, this is also a hardware configuration in our test bench. The user or the end application which can think of using this parameter as a dynamically configurable value, they can decide on during the hardware configuration phase itself whether to optimize, like whether to enable or optimize this value, or to provide the control hooks to the software so that the software can take up and enable or disable in the runtime based on the use case requirements. We have reached the conclusion of this presentation. So we have explained some of the useful tunable registers such as max payload size, the max read request size, the ECRC overhead, the ASPM latencies, and the link speed and the link width also. It can be tweaked in any way possible to achieve the desired result on the particular SOC which uses PCIe for communication. Also, we could see the tunable register shows successful improvement and in-depth understanding on the hindrances such as finding the optimal packet size, the buffer size, the scheduler latencies, and so on. Since the experiment is done on ARM64 based platform, the future scope of this research can also be extended to other architectures such as AMD x86, which will identify whether the enabling of CPU causes bottlenecks and whether the multi-threading or the operation frequency of the SOC is causing a bottleneck for the PCIe or not. Thank you all for attending the presentation.